All right, so I'm Jarad Held. I'm from Fidelity, and I'm here to kind of present a use case for as an end user for Envoy to you guys today. And I'm here with Matt Turner from Tetra, who's going to talk a little bit about some of the work they're doing as well with the Envoy gateway. First off, not endorsement of any vendors or anything along those lines. Standard disclaimer, make sure, I am Jarad Held. I'm a principal software engineer. I've been working with Fidelity for the last 10 years. I actually started off with APIs when I first joined Fidelity as an intern. And since then, I moved around to a couple different business units. And I eventually ended up rejoining the API platform team once we came to kind of modernize the platform from the different systems that we'd been using previously.
I guess I'm a software engineer at Tetra. I do a lot of community-facing open source stuff, so I've been really interested in Envoy Gateway and WASM and Web0 and those kind of projects. So I've been really interested in the ways that we've been helping Fidelity out, because a lot of it is based on sort of open source work, or is going to be, and that's what I'm going to talk about later.
We've obviously gone on a long journey in our API platform in Fidelity, from a variety of different vendors and doing things homegrown, and we've always had a number of different objectives when we were going to be building out an API platform, looking for specific features, figuring out how to perform everything at scale, and obviously wanting to do this in an open source friendly manner. So Fidelity has always been really looking to innovate as it's kind of gone through the years. I mean, it's, from starting when they first purchased computers, to when they launched the homepage for people to trade funds, to trade stocks and mutual funds and everything. And, all the way to our cloud journey and deploying applications today. So in Fidelity, we've had a couple different vendors that we've used, couple different solutions. Some of it was on-prem, some of it was based in the cloud, in via SaaS. But, each different solution had a little bit of a different issue, right? It could be that, each business unit had its own gateway. It could be that, it wasn't necessarily cloud-friendly. It could be a little bit difficult to upgrade them as a result, because it could be split out amongst different BUs. There was a variety of different issues. We tried to solve that with a SaaS gateway. That solved some of the issues. We were able to deploy things automatically without having to go and manually configure things. It was friendlier, but it didn't really quite do everything that we needed it to do. It didn't quite conform to what Fidelity was looking to do for requirements. I'm going to take this off. So we started looking for a new solution. And we wanted to do that open source. There were a couple of different objectives that we had. We wanted it to be a relatively simple gateway. We didn't want anything that was really heavyweight. And obviously, Envoy is going to be pretty lightweight. We wanted it to be highly resilient in case any components failed, so that way we wouldn't have any downtime and we'd be able to continue to serve our customers. We wanted it to have some features that were already inbuilt, like quota and security, things that we wouldn't have to redevelop on our own. Obviously, we only wanted best class performance, and we wanted to be able to do things at a minimal cost. So that's where our whole FinOps optimization comes in, and figuring out, if we use Envoy, are we going to be able to run faster, and are we going to be able to run at a lower cost? And obviously, the answer was yes. Flexible. So with the filters types that Envoy provides, whether we'd be able to actually build out the different features that are necessary to run our gateway. And then obviously we had some different languages that we wanted to support as well, as we're going to be developing those different features. So that's where we started looking at a variety of different solutions, things that were vendor based, things that were open source, things that were based in the cloud, things that were based on-prem, trying to figure out what's the proper solution. So we went through an evaluation about 2 years ago, when we started on this whole journey trying to figure out what are we going to do to build a new gateway. And ultimately, we did arrive at Envoy. When we did the evaluation of Envoy, we realized that there's a lot going for it. I mean, there's obviously the observability and tracing that we've heard of today, which, you know, a lot of solutions didn't really have that level of depth when it came to that. The dynamic configuration via XDS, which we use in our own control plane, right, where you can configure that dynamically and in real time. The FinOps optimization, obviously, as I mentioned, in order to reduce our costs while we're doing all of these deployments. The multi-language filter support, so that way, you know, whether it was done in C++ or Lua or Golang, whatever that may be, that we would be able to support that. We wanted something that was additionally close to the service mesh, right? Obviously, Envoy is very close to that. So that way, once we were building out this gateway, maybe we could do something with service mesh as well. REST, gRPC, WebSockets, webhooks, we wanted support for all of those things. And additionally, we wanted to modernize our ingress through the edge to our internals. And obviously, we wanted to use this gateway on our internals as well. And obviously, as I mentioned, Envoy has top performance in class. So when we chose Envoy, we still had the problem of, well, OK, we've chosen a runtime for our gateway. What are we going to be doing for building out the rest of it? Right, we needed to build out a management plane. We needed to build out a control plane. And that's what we proceeded to do over the last 2 years. So what you're seeing on your screen here is what we have something that we call internally as the Stratum API platform. It provides a number of different things. As you can see, there's the multiple protocol support. And then we're also using a variety. We built out a different variety of different tools to support this, as well as our own management UI. Where you can go in, you can self-service deploy an API and have that appear on the Envoy gateway itself. And then, based on OAS specs, and then additionally configure your API to use certain filters. So we have a whole bunch of different tools and capabilities that we've built into the platform in order to best serve our customers' needs and for our development team's needs. So the idea behind this is that regardless of the underlying technologies, that the API lifecycle stays the same across whatever product that you end up using, essentially, right? So we wanted to make sure that that was going to be stable no matter what we did. And one of the things that we did really consolidate on early on was to continue using OAS3 contracts to ensure that during any deployment that every API uses an OAS3 contract, make sure that, you know, we have the full definition when we go to deploy. It's fully self-service, right? We have both platform managed and we're able to discover non-platform APIs as well, things that aren't strictly running through a gateway today. And we're using domain modeling as well to make sure that we are able to classify those APIs appropriately. We also have the API tooling, as I've mentioned before. There's a test studio that we built out that allows us to go and test APIs after they've been deployed. Different SDKs, we have a CLI that you can use to actually go and get information about what APIs are running and information like that. And then we have a variety of different other tools that we've built out, like breaking change validation, where if you've deployed an API, you want to make sure that it's not going to go and, you know, break an existing deployment before you've actually deployed it. And as well as things like compliance APIs, where we can ensure that when you are deploying something that you're not violating a security standard or, a particular rule about which verbs are being used or whatever that may be. So as a part of that, right, what you're seeing on the screen here is a simplified diagram of what we've actually built out. There's the management plane, right, which allows us to publish those APIs. We have an API publishing API, so that way, no matter which, you know, CI/CD solution you're using, that you can go and call that API in order to publish that. That will then flow into a database that we have deployed, right? And you can additionally deploy that API via the Stratum UI. So that way, you have both that self, it's fully self-service either via CI/CD or through the UI. from there, what we have is we have the XDS, right, that control plane. The control plane is consuming that information from an API, which links to the Stratum database. So that way we can actually, on Bootstrap, we can pull up that list of APIs that people have published, no matter whether that's in AWS or Azure or on-prem or wherever that may be, wherever our gateways are. Additionally, one of the things that we're also going to be doing is we're going to be integrating that XDS with Kafka, so that way when somebody does publish an API, that it can just flow automatically in real time into the gateway. So that way there's no like latency, no waiting time for after you publish your API for it to be able to actually, you to be able to call it. Once that goes into there, obviously the Envoy consumes that as well as all the other components that we have, so that way you are able to call your APIs through the gateway. So one of the other things that we wanted to do is we really wanted to modernize how we're doing things too. So for both the edge and internally. We first started on our journey with the internal side of things, building out the gateways internally, and then additionally making sure that everything functioned correctly, ran quickly, supporting all the different business unit use cases, adding the different authorization filters, and supporting different protocols like the gRPC and the REST and everything like that. Then more recently, we've also been focusing on the edge modernization as well. As you can see on the left-hand side, we were coming through a firewall and then a SaaS gateway. And then, in the DMZ, there's a variety of different solutions that are lined up. That's, how things worked previously. And what we're doing now is we're really deploying Envoy in the DMZ. So that way, you only have that singular ingress point, that singular hole through the DMZ for you to be able to call through. So it increases security and also makes sure that our infrastructure is, that's the word I'm looking for, that our infrastructure is all consolidated into one particular pattern. So as we're building out that gateway, we had a decision to make as to how we're going to be implementing these different filters, these different features that we were going to be needing on the gateway. And we did an evaluation when we were doing that, and we came across the different filters that you saw in front of us. This by no means is all of them. But when we did our evaluation, we typically broke it down into, okay, well, we could build C++ filters, right? But as you may know, it can be difficult to find a talented C++ developer. It could be hard to, retain them. And, we additionally would have to build the Envoy binary if we were going to be doing that. So we really wanted to try to avoid that unless we were going to be doing something that required, the fastest speed that you could. So we then moved on to looking at kind of Lua and WASM and some of the external processing filters and everything along those lines. For a large majority of our filters, we actually use Lua because it's a very simple interface in order to be to program with that with, the very simple hook into the actual Envoy. And we use it for some of our simpler filters, and additionally to make some callouts as well to external authorization APIs as well. More recently, we've been moving into the XAuths filter type as well, for certain APIs as well, and then the external processing filter. We haven't gotten into WASM too much yet, but we are evaluating that more recently as that's matured a bit, and we're very excited about the future of WASM on Envoy as well. One thing that we've done in Envoy is to ensure that we're able to meet the different use cases that the business units have. They might have different filter requirements. We deploy it in a centralized model, the Envoy gateway. And what it is that we have something that we call the orchestration filter. When people deploy their APIs, they can specify a particular tag, essentially, that lets the Envoy know which filter flow to actually execute. So it may require, one API may require validating a JOT. One may be an opaque token. One may be an API key. And it may need to sign a JOT later down the line or generate a different token. Who knows what it may be, right? There's a lot of different use cases out there. And we wanted to make sure that we were able to support that. And that's where this orchestration filter comes in. The orchestration filter is essentially a Lua filter that interprets that tag and then uses that in combination with composite filters in order to execute that those filters on a conditional basis. And that's effectively what that's doing. So it's really good for when there are common patterns and use cases and everything along those lines, right? But we did have a little bit of a problem, something that we're trying to solve. And what that is that it's not the best use case for when we have something that's very API specific. So in the case of like a vendor or something along those lines who needs to make a call into Fidelity, they might have supply a different kind of token, or they might do a different type of signature or something along those lines. So like simple use case here, there were four different APIs that were onboarded recently. One of them used IP whitelisting only, one was only API keys, and then I had two different types of signature validation that were coming through as well. So one where the signature was just in the header, one where it was in a JOT, and so you need to validate the JOT and the signature inside of the JOT. So you can have a wide variety of different use cases. In that particular case, you have to build a filter for each one, and then you know that you add that to the global filter chain. So we're trying to figure out a way to solve that. But while we're trying to figure out a way to solve that, we also saw that there was a really big increase in performance. So what you're seeing on the screen here is based off, compared to some of the other gateways that we had been using internally previously, we're really seeing about 3 to 4 times performance increase when we're using Envoy. And we know we can get faster on this as well. So what you're seeing is that when on our old gateway, when we were running, this is on a single pod instance, the old gateway was only able to run about 300 TPS. For Envoy, we were able to run 1,000. Part of that's due to the reason that we use Lua filters, and as we transition over to WASM and other filter types, we do expect it to get faster as well. So one of the things that we're looking to do is the whole use case that I mentioned where you have different APIs and they require different authentication mechanisms that are very specific to those APIs, is we wanted to try to make Envoy a bit more flexible. So what we've done is we're building out something that we're calling either policy engine or function engine, naming to be determined, right? But essentially what it allows you to do is that using a configuration-based approach that you can apply different functions essentially in a sidecar that's going to be running that will allow you to do things like parse the, grab that JOT out of the header, grab the signature within the body of the JOT, and then be able to hash the body to get that signature in addition to actually validating the JOT using something like the JOT authentication filter. So that way we can have that more flexible approach to be able to support the very different APIs out there and the different vendors. So it's one of the things that we're really looking forward to doing, and especially we're also hoping what this will do is for those of our developers within Fidelity who don't know Envoy at all, that they can go and use these policies without ever having to actually touch Envoy or even know that it's really running underneath.
Cool, thanks. So I'm just going to talk briefly about some of the work that Takeout and Fidelity are going to do in this area sort of together in the future, and about a lot of the stuff that's happening in the sort of open source arena, because a lot of this is going to be based on that, and I think it's pretty exciting. Thanks. We're trying to synchronize laptops here. It's not, the production values might not be perfect. I think we've done a lot of great work together so far. Right, and a lot of these areas we were sort of ahead of the market. I mean, the external processing stuff was done before that was an official thing, right? It was kind of clutched in, but it worked. But in a lot of those places, the market has now caught up, and I think we can take advantage of that, and I think anybody else who's in the same position can take advantage of that stuff too. So one of the first things I want to talk about is the Envoy Gateway project that you've probably heard sort of Denyans talk about this morning. I think it's fair to say a lot of the stuff that we built was, quite difficult, or at least, long-winded to build. And of course, now it's got to be maintained. So I think one of the things that Fidelity could obviously do is move onto Envoy Gateway, right? So this is the control plane of that. Like the core of it is the Go control plane library. the same as Monzo's custom service mesh uses, the same as Fidelity's stuff uses. So this is all 100%, the sort of core of this is 100% tested code. And while Tetrae is proud of having a couple of the main contributors to Envoy Gateway, it is an open project with a big community backing in, so it's not going to go anywhere. And by adopting that, I think it's an obvious win where Fidelity won't have to be their own vendor, right? And I think the other big area of innovation that's really going to help everybody is WASM, right? So you've talked about all of the extensions we've put into Envoy, making it into kind of a full-featured API gateway kind of thing. All those functions that everybody needs, like job validation, like OIDC auth, like rate limiting, like body validation, the whole lot. And all of that stuff can be added to Envoy in various ways, as we saw, right? But obviously WASM is probably the way to do that going forwards. So I think doing that together, we can build this whole ecosystem of these plugins that can turn Envoy into a sort of fully featured API gateway project to rival the best commercial ones that I'm sure a lot of people here have used because they need the features but maybe had some bad experiences with. And if we manage the Envoys through the Envoy Gateway control plane, then that becomes really easy to do as well, because Envoy Gateway implements the Gateway API, which is this sort of new emerging standard way to configure all kind, all the ingress controllers you might ever have in Kubernetes. And we're working on extensions to that. So we're working on making that API sort of modular and pluggable and having it be able to model all of these more advanced API gateway features. So as people in the community write these plugins with a sort of an API gateway feature, maybe a certain type of signature validation, we can get a module, a component of the gateway API that will model that and make it sort of configurable in a standard way, no more jumping into the old sort of annotations on the ingress object kind of thing. And I think, as you said, like WASM just makes a lot of this like a no-brainer. That flowchart you had was perfectly valid, sort of 12 months ago. But hopefully, the answer going forward is going to be, WASM is the answer, right? And so all that really leaves is just the language wars of, well, what do we write and compile into WASM, and your colleagues who are too stupid to realize that Rust isn't the right answer all the time. If you don't like Rust, then you're not only wrong, but you can use, there's a whole bunch of other things you can use. Tiny Go is something I think is not on a lot of people's radars. It's a subset of the Go language. We've done a bunch of work on the compiler. That compiles down to WASM quite nicely. So if you've got an infrastructure team that's familiar with Go, then that's a good thing to use. But so the jokes aside, I think it's important. I think the WASM stuff addresses a bunch of real world concerns. Like, it is a cool tech. It does have a lot of hype, but this isn't just a science experiment. I mean, we've seen how well the performance has increased already, by moving to Lua. And I think, as you say, that's only going to be better when we move to WASM, especially if you're writing in a cool low-level language with zero cost abstractions. It doesn't have a GC. Rust aside, it's another project that we've all been working on in the community is, I think, called WASZero, right, which is a Golang WASM VM. So you can now host WASM inside a Go program. So you could use that to write a test harness for an Envoy plugin or something. Or I think maybe more relevantly, the external processing that you were talked about. So a lot of the stuff that Fidelity does is actually going to have to stay in an external processing filter, because it needs to make like a bunch of network calls and stuff that you just can't do from WASM plugins inside Envoy. It needs to talk to IDPs and cert providers and stuff, I think, doesn't it? So some of that stuff's going to have to stay external. Obviously, Jarad talked about building that system out to be this sort of DSL-based thing that people who aren't familiar with Envoy can use. That, for example, could be written in. I'm riffing here, I don't actually know what your plan is, but like that, if anybody else is in a similar position, you could write something like that in Golang, and you could make that itself pluggable using WASZero, right, to host our sort of WASM extensions into that. So, yeah, I don't think I have any more slides. I think that's basically all I was going to say. There's a bunch of stuff going on in the community around Envoy and Envoy Gateway and WASM, and especially Golang. There's a bunch of design docs up there. There's a bunch of open source repos. We'd love to see everybody get involved, because there must be a whole lot of people who've got very similar requirements. And I think we can all come together and build something awesome.
So yeah, if there are any questions at this time. I wouldn't say that we know explicitly that it's the Lua filters. I mean, we chose Lua originally because it's simple and it runs relatively fast. I can't say that it's explicitly. We're still learning today, even as it is, exactly how to configure Envoy in the best ways. As everybody knows, Envoy can be a little complex. So I'm sure this is probably something that we've missed that we could use to, you know, help improve that performance as well. But we do know that WASM really would help improve on that performance as well. So I wouldn't explicitly say it's the Lua filters. We've been very happy with them so far. Oh, and in case anybody can hear that question, basically the question was, do we know that it's explicitly the Lua filters that are slowing, keeping us at 1,000 TPS? So we've used a couple different filter types within Fidelity. I didn't really cover them all, there's generally been a trend towards using Lua actually internally, simply because the how you integrate it is relatively easy. I mean, it has just the Envoy on request, Envoy on response. It's a very simple, it's plain as day how you implement it, right? Additionally, it can make the callouts that are necessary via the HTTP call, which is one of the wider use cases that we see when somebody's making a call to an API that they may need to do for authorization. Just things that might be simpler as well within the Envoy as well. When it comes to other more complex use cases, if we need to assign a jot, right, we do some re-signing of jots with specific keys, essentially, to go to specific targets. And for that, what we did is, before the external processing filter really came into its own, we built out our own C++ filter, which did that gRPC connection to a sidecar in order to do that kind of jot signing. It's a mixture of Lua, some homegrown C++, and we're also gonna be using the external processing filter today as well for the policy engine and things like that. That we're gonna be seeing a lot more use of the external processing filter.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.